In this video, I want to show you how I created this render of a handmade model facade detail. So this is from our office building project from which we have already made some really cool renders. Still, a project is only complete if you have some pictures of maquettes that give a different perspective of the project, even if you made them digitally. I also want to thank Millennium for sponsoring this video, but much more on them later. So let's start with our 3D model in SketchUp. This is an overview of the 3D model, as some of you have seen from our past videos. It's really nothing fancy, and as a matter of fact, it's lacking detail in many parts. Now, we need to define the section of our building that we will use for our facade detail. If we look at some references of different facade details, we can see that some are represented as cinematic projections and others as parallel facade drawings. This specific one is interesting because although it's represented straightforwardly, you can understand how the facade is built and its different parts. So if you go to our SketchUp model, this part is the one I think looks most interesting to show as a facade detail. Well, it shows the different alternations of the facade, how the glass backs away from the edge of the concrete slab to give way to the balconies and lookout spots, and how on the first floor we see a facade composed of spaced out wood paneling. I'll use the section tool inside of SketchUp to limit the model and hide the rest. Although I'm working entirely on SketchUp, you can do this with Revit, Rhino, and other 3D modeling programs. To activate more than one section, you must have your sections in different groups. As you can see, if I create two sections in the same group, only one will be active. But if I group my model a few times for each of the sections I'm going to create, I'll be able to see all of them active. So here I'll go inside the first group, select the section tool and position it. I'll go inside the second group and repeat the process. Now I'll do the same for the other parts. This takes some time and may be annoying, but at the moment, I haven't found any way to work around this in SketchUp. When defining our facade details model limits, you want to ensure you don't cut out in the middle of any important details. Also, you don't want to have the section as deep as possible. We want to show how the facade works most of all, so the structural system and materiality. As soon as I've defined my facade detail area within the section tool, I'll save the scene so I can return to it whenever I need. Now, let's go on to our favorite part, the rendering. Before I start, I want to look at some references of how I want my digital maquette to look. And for this, I love using Millennote. Millennote is a tool for organizing your creative projects like this one. When you go into Creative Studio, they have things for a project stuck up on a wall, sketches, reference images, ideas, notes, and diagrams. Well, Millennote is just like that, but it's entirely online and the walls are infinite. Millennote is a place to collect and organize your thoughts and ideas, organize checklists of everything that needs to be done, visualize and gather inspiration, and set a visual direction for a project. So I'm currently using Millennote to gather all of the references of architectural models I like and highlight anything I want to remember in the future. I particularly enjoy the pen tool where I can scribble and jot down ideas. It feels much more like a sketchbook than a rigid app. Millennote gives you a bird's eye view of everything happening, and when you're ready to share your work, you can invite your colleagues and clients, gather essential feedback, and collaborate with them in real time. And starting a project is really easy with over 100 built-in templates available for designers, photographers, filmmakers, and more. Finally, Millennote is available for free with no time limit. Sign up using the link in the description and start your next creative project. So let's continue. Some of you may know how this part works, some of you may not, so I'll just go over it again. I like to start by creating a plane and a background wall. This is so the model looks like it was placed on top of a table and it's not an actual 3D model. Then I like to open V-Ray and create test renders to see what I'm looking at. As you can see, we need to modify the light and the materials to make this look much more realistic. Also, you want to modify your section parameters so the visualization doesn't present any errors. So I always like to adjust with the V-Ray interactive render on, but you can turn it off if you like. I'll start by turning off the sunlight and adding a rectangle light. I'll scale this light and rotate it just like you would with a lamp on top of a table. Now I'll change the position and scale it until it looks interesting. I like soft shadows on the ground and not such harsh light intensity. These are the settings I use for this particular render in my light. Now I'm going to modify the materials to make this look more like a handmade model and not so much like a render. I'll go into the Chaos Cosmos library, download a maquette wood material, and apply it to my model. You want to make sure you change the texture size to a bigger one. So if it says 1.2 meters, I'll scale it up to 12 meters. I also want to ensure the texture positioning goes along with the architectural element and the orientation of that element. So for example, in these columns, I want the wood striations to be vertical, not horizontal, and the concrete slab faces, I want them to be oriented correctly. For the glass, I'll use a material called fake glass inside the Cosmos library. And now I'm going to go inside the 3D warehouse and look for low poly people. I'll download a few and place them on different floors. This is a great technique to understand the scale of the project. Also, you want to make sure the model is really low poly. If not, they will look smooth and perfect for the scale at which we're representing the project. So before hitting the render button, I'm going to go to the depth of field option and in V-Ray and turn it on. You can play around with the setting. You don't want to exaggerate too much on this one. Also, go to your render channels and click on render ID, ambient occlusion, and cryptomat. Now we will set our final resolution and hit the render button. And this is how the final render looks. Now I'll save all these images and import them into a Photoshop file. First, I'll turn on the ambient occlusion and set it to multiply. This will add some extra context shadows to the maquette. Now I'm going to turn on the render ID and select all the window frames with a magic wand. Once they're selected, I'll turn off and deselect the render ID layer, go to adjustments, and click on hue and saturation. I'll change the light and saturation so the wood looks painted white. I'll repeat the same selection process for the columns, but here I'll keep the color of the same, just the light and saturation. So no two pieces of wood are alike, so you want to show this by changing the light and saturation of each element. Next, I'll merge all of this information into one layer and convert that layer into a smart object. Now I'm going to go into the camera raw filter. Let's increase exposure, decrease the contrast, increase the texture and clarity, and modify the red, orange, and yellow colors mostly so it looks closer to natural wood. In the end, you will want to have this reddish wood kind of feel. Now press OK and let's go back. Although this image looks perfect, we can add one extra step, which is the "this looks too good to be true" step. We will intentionally mess up our image so it looks more like a handmade model with human mistakes and less like a 3D model with perfect corners. First, we'll use the clone tool and to extend some of the window frames and make them look not as straight. Next, we will make our wood dirtier by using the burn tool. We'll make some wood parts look ugly and at a very low opacity. We'll also use the clone stamp tool to make our bottom slab look jagged and imperfect. These imperfections are really up to you. Just take a look at some hand models and search for imperfections. Then try to replicate these imperfections in your image. So this was the final image. This was how it evolved with each detail. We added a white background, one key light, changed the materials to natural maquette materials, added low poly people, moved it into Photoshop, and added some intentional errors. Make your own facade detail with this technique, upload it to Instagram, and tag us. I would love to see how you can create imperfect images and achieve realistic results. If you want to see more tutorials on the same project, click on this video right here, and that's it. See you in the following video. Thank you all for watching. Bye.